So tonight we gather for the fifth and final pair of lectures in our series, Dante, Mercy, and the Beauty of the Human Person. I'm Leonard DiLorenzo, and on behalf of the entire Institute for Church Life and our director, Professor John Cavadini, I'm very pleased to welcome you all here this evening. When we first conceived of this lecture series in which we would journey with Dante from Lent to Easter, we also expected that our journey would bring us from winter to spring. But alas, South Bend had other plans. South Bend demands that we expect the unexpected, does it not? What we also couldn't have expected was the richness of this journey, not only with Dante, but with each other in these evenings of reflection and conversation. We've been treated to explorations in mercy and beauty while contemplating the themes of longing and desire, while looking to the city of God to know the peril of the inferno, and of looking up again to glimpse the fullness of knowing and of being known. We've been comforted and challenged as readers who always begin midway in the midst of life, and whose own good is always connected to the good of others. We've pondered the healing of eyes untied from fixation to fascination, where admiration dawns, and we gazed upon the aesthetic beauty of the heavenly realms that always lie before us as a task and as a gift. And now tonight we conclude this series with a pair of lectures that invite us to contemplate the end of the journey in heavenly bliss. As with our other evenings, we will take a short break in between our two lectures, but unlike our other evenings, we have delicious dessert treats outside that await us at the break. Dessert and conversation will take the place of our typical question and answer period. And with that, I would like to move on to introduce our first lecturer this evening. Jessica Keating does a lot. To begin with, she is director of the Office for Human Dignity and Life Initiatives in the Institute for Church Life. In this role, she helps Notre Dame to persuasively define and defend human dignity in every stage and situation of life. Her work includes, for example, helping faculty to develop life-related pedagogical resources, writing on a broad array of cultural and ethical topics, and collaborating with other university offices to provide support to pregnant and parenting students. Earlier this very week, Jess coordinated a major conference on the question and meaning of human dignity, which included talks by the Cardinal Archbishop of Abuja, Nigeria, as well as leading scholars in theology, philosophy, law, and political science. Jess is also studying theology at the doctoral level, where her primary research interest in the theological anthropology of the child will draw broadly on theological and philosophical resources and seek to hold in tension the lost memory of the beauty of creation and the often neglected hope of our blessed end in Christ. The beauty and hopefulness of childhood is no merely intellectual interest for Jess, since every Sunday morning she practices the catechesis of the Good Shepherd at St. Matthew's Cathedral Parish here in South Bend, where she enables the imaginations of 4-, 5-, and 6-year-olds to flourish through direct contacts with the symbols and the stuff of Catholic liturgy and devotion. Her own written work, in which she seeks to uphold the dignity of life, to nourish the Catholic imagination for big, dull grown-ups like ourselves, and to help raise the level of discourse in both popular and academic circles, has appeared in such publications as America Magazine, Aletheia, and Church Life. If you've read Jess's writing, you have read some of the most timely, learned, and clear-minded articles on life issues. Jess is a graduate of Notre Dame's Master of Divinity program, prior to which she not only taught at the Red Cloud School on the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation, but also drove the school bus to and fro every day. Indeed, Miss Frizzle has nothing on Jessica Keating. And since it's April and hope springs eternal this time of year, I should also take this rare opportunity to say that Jess is a loyal fan of the AL East leading Baltimore Orioles. Not to last long. Speaking to us this evening on Love's Recollection, Paradiso, and Healed Memory, please join me in welcoming my friend and colleague, Jessica Keating.
Thank you, Lenny, for that very kind introduction. Since the beginning of the Year of Mercy, I have tried to be attentive to the very small and even obscure ways that people practice mercy. But this evening, I am the recipient of a great act of mercy on Lenny's part, namely, not making me follow Cyril O'Regan. Evidence that the mercy of God does indeed endure forever. So for that, 1,000 thank yous, and thank you to everyone for joining us for our fifth evening here together. Tonight we come to the end of our lecture series, though not the end of our journey with Dante, who Pope Francis called a prophet of hope, a herald of humanity's possible redemption and liberation, of profound change in every man and woman, of all humanity. Dante invites us to regain the lost and obscured meaning of our human journey and to hope to see again the bright horizon which shines in the full dignity of the human person, end quote. Over the course of these past 8 weeks, we have alighted upon the theme of memory several times, noting how souls ask to be remembered in purgatory and in hell, how memory functions in the various canticles, and how speech and memory are correlative. This evening, I'd like to take up this theme again, and perhaps a bit more explicitly, gathering together what has already been said, and hopefully adding something new, or at least saying it in a new way. In particular, I will consider the Eucharistic dimensions of memory as they are inflected in Inferno, Purgatorio, and Paradiso. Memory is a complex and elusive phenomenon, and despite our best efforts to plumb its depths and map out its mechanisms and meanings, it remains veiled and a constant reminder that the human person is not, after all, a mere collector of facts and data, but a perceiver of meaning and mystery. Constitutive of personal identity in community, memory functions even where recollection is not consciously willed. And children, Lenny mentioned my love of children. Children provide a particularly saturated example of protological memory. I have two nephews and one niece, ages 4, 7, and I think 3 weeks. My 7-year-old nephew is fully conscious of the reality of memory. He delights in recounting sporting events to those willing to listen to a full 9 innings of Orioles baseball, or the various lead changes in a basketball contest. He has also started to discover the reality of forgetting, and incidentally, some of its benefits. Forgetting to pick up after himself, or to eat parts of his lunch, are frequent refrains in my sister's home. For his 4-year-old brother, memory is not yet discreetly connected to time or will. He is currently enchanted with the movie Inside Out, and he frequently asks his parents if they would open his head so he could look at his core memories. And for most young children, past events for him retain an unreflective immediacy. What happened a year ago could just as easily have happened 5 minutes ago, or could be inflected as something he is currently asking or demanding to have happen. For their week-old sister, memory is utterly non-discursive and is thoroughly absorbed in the other, namely, at this point, her mother. She will not remember the first time my sister smiled at her, even as she incoherently understands that smile. Like her brothers, She will learn her native tongue from her parents, but will not recollect the experience of learning how to verbally express herself. Though language is a constitutive part of realizing human existence and for relating to those around her, she will retain no memory of her transition from babbling infant to articulate child. She will not be able to search through the recesses of her memory and exclaim, "Aha, here is where and when and how I learned to say apple instead of up, 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 up." She will not be able to remember the first time she said thank you or I love you. And yet this language, which she learns and practices unselfconsciously and effortlessly, first in the arms of her parents and later at their knees, will shape her personal identity. This language, which she does not create, but receives as gift within the matrix of family, will form her conscious and living memory. And for any woman who, like my sister, labors in pain to bring forth a child, does not forget the pain of labor, and yet somehow this experience of pain is reinterpreted in the light of love of her child. Women generally do not suffer amnesia with regard to the birth of children. Rather, love and joy cover over the pain of bringing forth a child, shaping and refiguring a mother's vision of the crucible of childbirth. These observations are fairly general and do not take into account the memory of personal sin. So imagine the wound of infidelity. How is the memory of such a transgression constitutive of and deactivated by the phenomenon of forgiveness? In other words, how does forgiveness reconfigure sin? On the one hand, the event of betrayal has to be remembered in order to be forgiven. Yet on the other hand, memory of transgression cannot be so strong that it precludes forgiveness. Where the impossible gift of forgiveness occurs, it affects both the one who extends forgiveness and the one forgiven, such that their relationship is not merely restored to its previous state, but is elevated and enabled anew. As a phenomenon of excess, forgiveness does more than disable the effective memory of sin. Yes, it removes those parts of ourselves that are dead because of sin. We can say the guilt of the offending party is dead. But forgiveness actually does more than remove the effects of sin. It also capacitates us anew in the mode of perichoresis. The one who extends the impossible gift of forgiveness covers over the betrayal of the one who commits sin in her steadfast love. She is reselfed according to this excessive gift of love by which she herself does not even comprehend. On the other hand, the one she forgives in receiving is given back to himself full, abled anew, and freed for communion. The impossible miracle of forgiveness happens, and when it does, it is not merely a formal recognition of relationship restored as it was before. It affects something new, something beyond human comprehension, but nevertheless actual and real. Each of the above examples, the child who learns language, the mother for whom the pain of childbirth becomes a sight of joy, the couple whose relationship is reconfigured by forgiveness, are delicate interplays between remembering and forgetting that operate within the brackets of love. The child who receives the gift of language does so in the context of the primal relationship of love. The woman who forgets the suffering of childbirth does so under the influence of love for her child, which effectively revises her memory of what is otherwise, I understand, a terribly painful event. And the couple that travels the impossible path of forgiveness remembers and forgets according to the excessive phenomenon of love expressed in the event of forgiveness. At this point, we can venture to say three things about memory. First, memory is constitutive of personal identity. As beings in relation with others, our memories are not solely our own possession. Memory is permeated by the presence of others. Second, memory is not merely the discrete recollection of facts. It is more than a cognitive operation. Human memory does not function in the same way as mechanical memory. Rather, it is interpretive, malleable, and open-ended. Third, love influences what and how we remember. As we have journeyed with Dante from Lent to Easter, we have encountered the mystery of memory, the mystery that is of remembering and forgetting. Trying to describe the experience of being drawn through the river Lethe, Dante encounters the limits of memory and poetic skill. He says, "I can't remember it, still less can I write." In fact, memory contours the entire comedy. Recall, for instance, that the entire poem functions in the ambit of memory. Dante is the apocalyptic seer who sees behind the veil and who his beloved Beatrice at one point charges with remembering his pilgrimage from the antechambers of Inferno to the heights of the Imperium. She says, and so to the aid of the world that lives all wrong, keep your eyes firmly on that chariot, and what you see, write down when you go back. Notice that Beatrice's command is predicated on self-gift. Whatever we might say about Dante's poetic conceit, and we could certainly say a lot, Beatrice reminds us that his privileged vision is not his possession. Rather, Dante receives as gift that which has been from the first a gift of divine descending mercy. Remember, as Lenny so beautifully described in his lecture, Dante's entire pilgrimage occurs precisely because he is remembered, first by Mary, then by Lucy, and finally by Beatrice. If canonic love prompts Dante's journey, his task as poet must participate in the order of such love. He is not to write down that which he sees and remembers for his own aggrandizement, but is to do so on behalf of the world that lives all wrong. Canonic memory thus works on a grand scale, structuring the whole of the comedy. If Dante's masterpiece is a poetics of conversion, it is also a poetics of memory. Its deformation, its reformation, and its redemption. Memory not only contours the poem as a whole, but shapes the internal workings of each canticle, of each relationship, of each person. Above all, however, the poetics of the Divine Comedy are a poetics of divine memory, as expressed in the excessive gift of divine mercy. This is perhaps why the Psalms figure so heavily in the comedy. They are, after all, saturated with images of God's merciful remembering. Psalm 136, for instance, praises the God of gods, the Lord of creation and redemption, who remembered us in our low estate, for his steadfast love endures forever. In Psalm 25, the psalmist petitions, "God, be mindful of your mercy, O Lord, and your steadfast love, for they have been of old. Do not remember the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me." Time and again, the psalmist implores God to remember or forget according to mercy and love. God's memory of us reaches its apex in Christ. Recall Mary's words. "He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and his descendants forever." God's remembering is not an indifferent act of mental recall or recollection, but the dynamic act of kenotic love which touches us in Christ. And so the comedy invites us to consider the mysterious fragility, complexity, and potency of memory as correlated to sight and speech, particularly liturgical speech, the speech of prayer. Dante dares to imagine the unimaginable reality of memory redeemed, that is, the reality of memory healed, redeemed and elevated, saturated by the gift of divine mercy. This lecture will have three parts. First, we will descend back into hell in the inferno, and look at the way memory is structured as an anti-memory or a counterfeit memory. Then we will turn to the purgatorio and explore the revision of memory. And lastly, we will discuss the actualization of forgiven memory in Paradiso. 1. Inferno as anti-memory. Even the Inferno is referred to the kenotic love actualized in Paradiso, though its reference is ultimately a merely fraudulent show. The dead remember, yet perhaps we might say they remember too much, or they remember wrongly. Here, where the dead grip their memories and refuse to allow them to be penetrated by another, memory destroys communion. It remains incurved, oriented to the past and to the self. Here, bodies reenact their sins for eternity, interpenetrating with increasing violence, culminating in the anti-liturgy of cannibalism. In the Inferno, as Professor Cavadini has already showed us, language functions in the mode of deceit and destruction. Sight functions in the mode of indifference and voyeurism. Space functions in the mode of disdain and violent encroachment. Memory is unchanging, unproductive, and functions in the mode of anxiety and pain. Many of the souls Dante meets in hell are very interested in him, only inasmuch, however, that he can be useful to them. The sodomites, observing that Dante speaks at so little cost and so well, entreat him to remember them to the living. And so, they say, should you escape from these dark haunts and go once more to see the lovely stars, when you with pleasure say, I was there, then do, we beg you, speak of us to others. Anxious to be remembered in the city of man, they call upon Dante to act as a kind of intercessor, yet an inverted one. These souls do not plead with the poet to be remembered in prayer, but beg to be remembered, that is, praised to others in the world. Even ostensibly pleasant memories make hell's inhabitants miserable. Recollecting her lust for Paolo, Francesca opines, there is no greater sorrow than in times of misery to hold at heart the memory of happiness. And yet, if you so deeply yearn to trace the root from which the love we share first sprang, then I shall say and speak as though in tears. For the souls in hell, memory is a source of wretchedness, fear, pain. Though perhaps its cruelty is no more starkly displayed than in the traitorous Count Ugolino's massive inversion of liturgical speech and memory. In the depths of hell, in Canto 33, he says to Dante, how hard you are, if thinking what my heart foretold, you do not feel the pain of it. Whatever will you weep for, if not that? By now, they had all woken up. He is referring to his sons. The time was due when, as routine, our food was brought. Yet each was doubtful, thinking of their dream. Listening, I heard the door below locked shut, then nailed in place against that dreadful tower. I looked at their dear faces, spoke no word. I did not weep. Inward, I turned to stone. They wept. And then my boy Anselmo spoke. What are you staring at? Father, what's wrong? And so I held my tears in check and gave no answer that day, nor all night. That followed on until another sun came up. A little light had forced a ray into our prison, so full of pain. I could now see on all four faces my own expression. Ugolino goes on to recollect the death of his son, Gatto, who, pitching forward at his feet, cries out, "Help me! Why don't you help me, Dad?" Like the blessed we encounter in Purgatorio and Paradiso, Ugolino remembers the details of his life. Indeed, he recollects the numbing pain of his and his son's imprisonment, demanding that Dante do what he refused to do, weep. He remembers right down to the sound of the nail sealing shut the prison door and the violence of light that exposes pain. So what is the difference between Ugolino's memory and the memory of those who labor on the terraces of purgatory and flicker and dance like flames in the Empyrean? It is precisely this. Ugolino's memory is an anti-memory, just as the liturgy he enacts is an anti-liturgy. The paschal references are unmistakable, yet counterfeit, as is his speech and his memory. The language of prayer is inverted, as Ugolino duplicitously seeks to make himself the reference point of his narrative. Recall that he sees only himself in the faces of his sons. And perhaps this is why the words of Gatto, which obviously mimic Christ's cry of lament, are impotent. The father refuses to weep. He remains unmoved. And there he died, Ugolino continues, redirecting Dante immediately back to himself. You see me here. Insofar as others are present, even his own sons, they are present as objects and competitors, always and eternally reflecting his own face. For Ugolino, remembering is a kind of forgetting, because it is a contracted, impenetrable, self-aggrandizing event. Compare Ugolino's anti-memory with Virgil's explanation of the burning expansiveness of Caritas on the Terrace of Wrath in Purgatorio 15. The good that, infinite beyond all word, is there above will run to love like rays, a light that comes to anything that shines. It gives itself proportion to the fire so that as far as Caritas extends, eternal worth increases over it. The more there are who fix their minds up there, the more good there is to love and more to love, and each as might a mirror give to each. Ugolino's sons reflect his face like a mirror, but they reflect nothing more for him than his own face. In purgatory, memory undergoes revision because personal identity turns outward to the other so that Caritas might burn brighter. The souls doing penance on these terraces are undergoing the process of being reselfed. Memory, speech, and sight are reconfigured in communion with others. Liturgical speech and practice enable these souls in purgatory to remember aright, to remember truthfully. In Paradiso, Dante will imagine the full realization of memory healed and Eucharistically configured. Purgatory, though, is the process by which souls learn how to assimilate their narratives to Christ. Like the souls in hell, the souls in purgatory ask to be remembered, but they ask to be remembered in prayer to the souls in heaven or to the men and women on earth whose intercessory prayer can speed these souls through purgatory. Indeed, some of the souls Dante encounters only escape the rings of hell because others have interceded on their behalf. They are remembered in prayer and entrusted to the memory of God. Dante's intercessory role in purgatory, unlike the inferno, is in the mode of mercy. Repentance for sin functions as an interpretive key in the purgatorio. And an essential part of repentance is memory and the revision of memory. On the various terraces of purgatory, souls are reselfed as they progress to heaven. And this reselfing is fundamentally tuned to the rhythms of liturgy by which they are assimilated into the person of Christ. The reformation of memory does not imply simple annihilation of memory, but rather it is the figuring of persons into the person of Christ. And thus the direction of the eyes is always upward toward the empyrean. The grammar of liturgical prayer is expressive. It lifts the eyes heavenward. In Purgatorio 8, Dante describes one such scene of prayer. Hearing the evening bell, he gazes at a single soul. This soul first joined his palms and lifted them, eyes fixed toward the Orient, as though to say to God, "For nothing else I care." Te lucis ante issued from his lips, and with such devotion, and each note so sweet, it made me wander out of conscious thought. Then, sweetly and devoutly, all the rest, their eyes turned to the turning of the supernal wheels, picked up from him and sang the hymn in tune. Singing the Ambrosian Compline hymn, these souls turn their gaze skyward toward heaven. Grounded in the self-giving and the self-surrendering of the triune God, prayer continues the process of assimilating souls into Christ, capacitating them for heavenly liturgy, for communion with Mary and communion with the saints. These souls in purgatory, as we have already heard, learn to pray. To pray is to be grafted into Eucharistic memory, to be assimilated into the mind of Christ, means to participate in the kenosis of the triune God. On the terrace of gluttony, Dante encounters Forese Donati, which, if you were here last week, you will remember we discussed in Father Chase Pepper's talk. His emaciated flesh prevents Dante from recognizing his old friend. Rather, his voice signals and makes visible the human identity of the face obscured in longing. "I never would have known him from his face," writes Dante, "but in his voice, all now was shown to me, that had in feature been lost or destroyed, that spark for me rekindled at a stroke, clear recognition of those much-changed lips, and once again I saw Forese's face." Crying aloud at Dante's approach, "For me, how great a grace," reveals the identity of Forese's face. Coordinating speech and sight in the ambit of prayer lifts the veil of obscurity. Acquiescing to Dante's request that he tell the truth about himself, Forese speaks of his purgatorial sufferings. "There falls," he said, "from the eternal mind, a virtue in that water and that tree back there, which sharpens and pares me down. And all these people weeping as they sing, because their gullets led them past all norms, are remade holy, thirsting and hungering. Cravings to eat and drink are fired in us by perfumes from that fruit and from that spray that spreads in fans above the greenery. Nor once alone, encircling around this space, is agony and pain refreshed in us. I call it pain. Rightly, I should say, solace. For that same yearning that leads us to the tree that led Christ in his joy to say, Eli, when through his veins he made us free." Ferrassi makes a daring claim, a claim that inverts Inferno 33. For Ugolino, suffering, and recall that his suffering is also in the mode of starvation, is merely the painful event of abandonment. Ferrassi, however, understands his suffering eucharistically, interpreting Christ's lament of abandonment on the cross as a cry of joy. In doing so, he names the central dynamic of purgatory, the intertwining of suffering and joy, by which souls who inhabit the various terraces learn to speak the truth about themselves. To speak the truth about oneself is to learn to speak anew. The process of repenting from sin is painful because it requires a burning away of those parts of oneself dead in sin. And yet this pain is simultaneously a solace. Yes, there is penance. There is weeping. Note that there is no weeping in Ugolino's narrative. He is incapable of weeping. There is thirsting and there is hungering. Yet it is by these very means that souls are remade holy. Dante imagines joy as interwoven with suffering, such that weeping and singing occur simultaneously. Joy is not simply the reward for those souls who grit their teeth through purgatory. Rather, it is embedded in the very act of penance. Unlike the Inferno, where suffering decapacitates communication and disfigures memory, in purgatory, pain regenerates the self, enabling the penitent to re-narrate their biography, to revise their memory in light of the cross. An essential part of purgatorial reconstitution of the self is learning to speak of oneself in Christ. And so Ferrassi must revise his memory as he speaks. Initially describing purgation as pain, he immediately corrects himself, amending his initial locution to, rightly I should say, solace. He comes to reinterpret himself in the very act of speaking in light of Christ, who enduring the sufferings of the cross cried out, Eli. We know this as Jesus' cry of abandonment from the Gospel of Matthew. Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani. My God, why have you forgotten me? The cry of lament, inverted by Ugolino, is now reinterpreted by Ferrassi, who declares that this very lament, the lament of abandonment, of being forgotten by God, is also a cry of joy, that the Father's forgetting is also a remembering, a making new. Ferrassi sees the speech, the revision of speech under the cross and in the light of the paschal sacrifice means that he is in the process of being penetrated, of being inued by the will of Christ, which is always the will of love. The Eucharistic contouring of this scene cannot be underestimated. The souls in purgatory are now being fully assimilated to the Eucharistic reality. Pope Benedict XVI captures the dynamics of this reality, which seems particularly appropriate on the terrace of gluttony. In the normal process of eating, he says, the human being is the stronger being. He takes things in and they are assimilated to him, so that they become part of his own substance. They are transformed within him and go on to build up his bodily life. But in the mutual relationship with Christ, it is the other way around. He is the heart, the truly existent being. And when we truly communicate, this means that we are taken out of ourselves, that we are assimilated into him, that we become one with him and through him, with the fellowship of our brethren. The Eucharist is only possible because the God who draws us beyond the present and into the future and into the mystery of the self-sacrificing love of the Trinity remembers us. God's memory of us in Christ funds the memory of the souls in purgatory. In learning to speak again and to remember anew, these souls are akin to the child who receives the gift of language from her parents. The liturgical language that permeates the Purgatorio is the grammar of prayer that comes to us as gift. We do not possess it by ourselves or for ourselves, but in a horizon that opens up and allows us to see the depth and beauty of reality. Among the souls in Paradiso, Dante encounters, as we do too, the impossible reality of healed memory. The blessed dead in paradise do not find themselves stripped of their historical and personal biographies. Rather, here we encounter souls who are fully given back to themselves in and for love. Memory in heaven is thus abled and disabled in specific ways, and the recollection of the self is the redemption of the particular person with her particular history, actions, and experiences. In the final instance, redemption that doesn't account for particularity undermines the scandalous particularity of the incarnation. In the sphere of the moon, Dante encounters Picardia, who explains in detail her position in the heavenly ranks. I am Picardia, as you'll know I am, and blessed among the many who are blessed in this slowest moving of the spheres. And though the part allotted us may seem far down, the reason is that, yes, we did neglect our vows. These were, in some part, void. She goes on to narrate not only her biography, but also confesses the story of Constance, who never let the veil fall from her heart. The blessed dead tell the truth of themselves in great detail. Picardia's recollection of herself is keen and astute, yet it is unmarred by grief, guilt, or anger. Rather, her memory, as she is quick to remind Dante, remembers in charity, which is the mode of heavenly existence and discourse. In the heaven of Venus, Dante encounters Quinzina de Romano and Falco. Quinzina, with the confidence of a bold child, declares that she forgives herself of her sexual sins and adds, "It does not brood on me, which to humdrum minds of yours seems hard." Falco, who is guilty of sexual vice when he was young and was also involved in the Dominican Crusade against the Albigensians, offers the following interpretation of his life. "I dwelt once on the shores of that great lake between Ebro and the Magra, whose stream briefly divides Genoan and Tuscan realms. Almost at one same point of dawn and dusk sit both Bugia and the place I was, which made its harbor warm with our own gore. Falco, they called me, those who knew my name. This heaven now bears my imprint, as once I on the earth beneath its influence carried its." For Dido, Belus's daughter in her love, harming Crusa and Sisyphus too, never burned more than when young, I untonsured. Yet here we do not repent such things. We smile, though not at sin. We don't think back to that, but at the might that governs and provides. In wonder, we here prize the art to which his power brings beauty and discern the good through which the world above turns all below. Embedded in Falco's narration of his life is the bold claim about the nature of the memory of sin and the conjugation of continuity and discontinuity. Sin is both remembered and forgotten. Like Paul, who writes to the community at Philippi that he has forgotten what lies behind him and strains forward to what lies ahead, Falco is perfectly capable of recollecting himself and narrating his personal history. Yet at the same time, sin is unremembered or disabled in such a way that the blessed smile, not upon the sin, but at the might that governs and provides. Falco both sees and unsees sin in the sight of God's providence. Thus, at one and the same time, there is continuity in memory. And yet the blessed dead remember more truthfully because all is recollected in Trinitarian brackets. That is in the dynamism of self-giving and self-surrendering love. Falco declares, here we do not repent of such things. In Paradiso, Dante dares to imagine actualized forgiveness. As a correlative to sight, memory grows finer and more acute in the realm of heaven. The revision of memory by divine love gives one back to oneself. In the Gospel of Luke, recall that Peter forgets Jesus' prediction that he will deny the Son of God three times. And it is not the cock crow, but the gaze of Jesus that prompts Peter's remembrance. The Lord turned and looked at Peter, and Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him, before the cock crows today, you will deny me three times. And then he goes out and weeps bitterly. Peter is made aware of himself because Jesus turns and looks upon him. Jesus remembers him. And at Emmaus, later in the Gospel of Luke, the eyes of the disciples are prevented from recognizing the risen Christ until the breaking of the bread. The Eucharistic memory of God capacitates their vision and revises their memory. They now recall, in light of the Eucharist, that their hearts were burning inside of them all the time. To be forgiven, then, is not an individual achievement or possession. Forgiveness is a profusion of love, a gift unmerited that does not operate in the realm of merely private consolation, but actually enables oneself to become a participant in the self-giving love that is the Trinity. Thus, the one forgiven is turned outward, ready to give one themselves over in love. This is precisely why the cross cannot be forgotten and Christ's wounds cannot be elided, even in heaven. This is why Swiss theologian Hans Urs von Balthasar, drawing on John of the Cross, declares that without the permanent wounds of the risen Lord, we would never have guessed the depth of the mystery of the Trinity. The eternal presence of the cross and of the pierced flesh of Christ are expressive of God's love and of God's remembering of us. And it is precisely the same love which reforms memory of souls. Indeed, it is through Christ's open wounds and the piercing of his sacred heart that the eternal life is opened, because his body is eternal life. Thus, for Dante, the cross is suffused with Christ who is light. In Paradiso 14, he has a vision of the cross. And here remembering surpasses skill. That cross, in sudden flaring, blazed out Christ, so that I can find no fit comparison. But those who take their cross and follow Christ, will let me off where wearily I fail, seeing that white dawn as lightning, Christ. From horn to horn, from summit to summit, there moved here scintillating points of light, bright as their paths met, bright as passing on. So minute specks of matter can be seen, renewing how they look at every glance, straight in their track, oblique, long, short, swift, and slow. The cross blazes out the light of Christ, simultaneously fulfilling and inflaming desire, attracting the saints of heaven in an encounter that produces an effulgence of light. It is the expressive reminder of love. When souls in paradise gaze upon the flaring cross, they see the light of divine love, and they apprehend the light that draws creation to itself. Eucharistic memory here culminates in praise. Under the influence of the excessive gift of forgiveness, the memory of sin's effects are disabled. In the Paradiso, knowledge and memory are fully and excessively reconfigured in love. Knowledge is no longer simply discursive, but intuitive and immediate. Senses interpenetrate. We see speech and hear light. Division is no more, though distinction remains. And so it is for the blessed dead. Memory of the wounding effects of sin, guilt, division, and hatred give way to admiration, praise, and thanksgiving. Where distance was experienced as division in earthly life, there now exists the interpenetration of love, the inewing of I and thou. Where rivalry existed, praise now takes its place. The actualization of forgiveness thus capacitates souls in Paradiso for full participation in the outpouring of love, which is why I think souls can weep in heaven. And now my spark of words, Dante writes, comes more short, even than what I can call to mind, than baby's tongues still bathing in mum's milk. In the last instance, the blessed dead's participation in the life of God is utter and excessive gift. The Eucharistic acclamation, Lord, I am not worthy, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed, is fulfilled, because Christ inews in all the dead. They also interpenetrate each other. And yet, this dynamism of inner penetration and self-donation also makes them more uniquely themselves. As angels swarm like bees and the faces of the saints sway to Caritas, where voices of children sing bathed in light, prayer becomes the regulative mode of discourse. All is immediacy, gift, and intuition. The smile of the child's mother or father discloses the gift of otherness in union of relationship. And as a child learns their native tongue in the arms of parents and receives the gift of language from beyond herself, the blessed dead are like babes, still bathing in mom's milk. They participate in the eternal circle of divine love, in the giving and receiving of the gift of themselves from beyond themselves. The mother who smiles upon her infant child then, whose smile the infant child receives as the gift and sign of another, pales in light of the love that moves the sun and stars. Conclusion, finally. To be remembered by God is to be mercied. And mercy requires a certain kind of forgetfulness, the kind of forgetfulness that covers over sin and deactivates it. Memory redeemed is Eucharistic memory. Memory that is, remembers in the brackets of kenotic love. And Eucharistic memory culminates in the praise of God. The psalmist declares, and we'll end here with Augustine. The psalmist declares, happy are those whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Expressing the power of God to reconstitute the penitent sinner and cover over the guilt of transgression, to put it out of sight, as it were. St. Augustine, in Book 10 of the Confessions, interprets Psalm 32 and remarks on the disabling of the memory of sin. Writing of his past evil deeds, Augustine finds reason to praise God, who has forgiven and covered over his sins in order to, quote, to make me glad in yourself, transforming my soul in faith by your sacrament. He imagines that readers and hearers of his confessions will delight, not because the deeds were evil, but because they existed once but exist no more. Certainly, Augustine does not suffer from amnesia with respect to the sins of his past. His memory is not annihilated. Indeed, he expends great effort detailing the sins of his youth in the first 9 books of the Confessions. Yet for him, as for the psalmist, these transgressions, though recalled, are no longer operative. They exist no more. Divine mercy has covered them over, transforming the sight of sin into sights of God's mercy, such that the evil of sin and the guilt attending transgression are no longer operative. With the psalmist, Augustine's remembering of past sin functions, or does not function as the case may be, according to the intervening and excessive grace of forgiveness, in which God reconfigures the sinner according to the gift of mercy. Forgiveness functions. It heals memory. For Augustine, as for the blessed dead in Dante's comedy, God's merciful memory of us, which also always involves forgetting and remembering, is not only restorative, though it is that, it elevates us, it capacitates us anew for participation in eternal giving and surrendering of love. In mercy, we are given back to ourselves, and the flames of memory, in the words of 20th century French poet Charles Péguy, burn in the Eucharistic love that has been leading the way all along. Redeemed memory is then Eucharistic memory. It is memory that remembers according to divine mercy. It is memory that remembers in God's memory. The love that is always reaching its dramatic excess on the cross. Thank you, and sorry for going over.